Atomic Heart is the first game from developer Mundfish. You are Agent P3, and in an alternate reality 1950s Russia, you work for the smartest man on the planet. His invention of polymer has changed the course of history. Flying machines, thought control, superpowers, governmental infighting, conspiracies, and manipulation are all major themes of this excellent title. Combat can have occasional balance spikes, and I did run into a lot of bugs. But I loved this story that was absurd early on, but by the end, it's one that pulled no punches in its critiques of power and those who wield it. So let's break it all down in the Xbox Era Review of Atomic Heart. The Shock games, namely System Shock and BioShock, are clear inspirations for Atomic Heart. You'll start the title in a city in the sky as parades are being held to honor the upcoming release of Collective 2.0, created by scientist Dmitry Sechenov. It is a neural network that allows humans to control robots with only their minds. Your player character, known as Major P3, Dr. Sechenov's right-hand man. Things quickly go awry and you are tasked with discovering what went wrong, why, and how to fix it. The story starts out a bit slowly and builds into something fantastic by the end of its 15 to 20 hour long runtime if you focus entirely on the main story. Supposedly, there's another 10 to 15 hours worth of side content that is available in the form of polygons. These are essentially challenge dungeons and the main way to unlock weapon attachments and other combat-focused unlocks. As always, I will do my very best to break down the feeling of the plot without giving away any direct spoilers. The basic premise of the game is that P3's memories of anything more than 2 years ago were lost as he was saved by Dr. Sechenov in a procedure that left him with total amnesia. And even if the game's endings did leave me feeling a little unsatisfied, all of the major mysteries were revealed and that journey to find them was immensely pleasing. The entirety of the game takes place in the vast facility 3826, a fictional base set deep in the USSR of 1955. Atomic Heart is an odd open-world game. If they didn't include a map when you were outdoors, you might never realize that it technically is one. As if you focus on the main quest entirely, the game never once really points you in the go explore at your leisure direction. There is an enormous amount of playable space here, but it's almost entirely optional. The reward for exploring are those polygons, aka the challenge dungeons. They house three chests. Each chest yields an unlock for your weapons, as well as the occasional blueprint you'll need to craft them in the first place. There is no fast travel available, and instead you'll end up driving old cars to each location. The only waypoints are those for missions, so exploring the open world can become occasionally frustrating. Navigating into and out of the map takes a few seconds each time, and there is no minimap available. By the time I rolled credits, I had only completed two of the dozen polygons and hadn't found a few of the weapon blueprints. I could see completionists spending 30 plus hours in this game easily, and warning, there are easily missed achievements tied to bosses you can only fight one time. Speaking of the fighting, one of my biggest concerns coming into Atomic Heart was the combat. Early gameplay showcases looked a little floaty and a spongy feel to the enemies. There are three difficulty options available, and on normal, which is what I played, I think it feels fantastic most of the time for combat. Your first weapon is an axe that swings nice and hard. Robot and human limbs, heads, and torsos will melt as your axe swings clean through them, and it feels damn satisfying. There are multiple melee weapons, each with its own specific upgrade paths and special abilities. My favorite was a quick-hitting axe that could turn into a ranged buzzsaw attack. To use special abilities, you'll need to use your glove's energy. You've got a super-powered robot glove that is a main part of the plot. To gain energy, you smack things with your melee weapon, and you'll unlock multiple energy-based weapons that use that same energy ammunition as well. The loop of smacking enemies to build up energy so that you can use special moves or your ranged weapons was fun the entire time. To complement this, there are also multiple ballistic-based weapons available, and you'll unlock a powerful pump-action shotgun early. There are pistols, assault rifles, and even a rocket launcher, which will be yours by the end, and each has its own upgrade tree. I didn't realize just how important that was at first, and the first major boss of the game kicked my ass. Once I had realized that I had accidentally skipped the tutorial for upgrading your weapons, I went into Nora, the upgrade sex robot, and powered my gear up. The boss was a cakewalk, and I only ran into a few more difficulty spikes throughout my time. Upgrades themselves are crafted through a large number of in-game consumables. Looting these is an immensely satisfying experience, as it is the exact opposite of Red Dead Redemption 2. Instead of slowly going through each drawer and shelf, you hold out your magic glove and suck everything useful into your pocket, which of course sports a mini black hole. Once you've pocketed a Walmart worth of goodies, you can go to Nora to craft ammo, health packs, and consumables. A key craftable is the weapon cartridge. There are ice, fire, and shock cartridges, which you can add an elemental flare for your weapon of choice. Combined with moves from your glove, which we'll get on next, you can take down the toughest enemies in no time. To find out what works best against each enemy type, you'll have to scan them, Metroid Prime style. It can be really hard to do so in the heat of combat though, as time doesn't slow down when you're scanning. The keybind is also odd on console controllers as well, where you need to double tap and hold on the second tap your right bumper, because normally right bumper is how you loot and interact with things. This led to me scanning a lot when I went to loot, or trying to loot when I went to scan. Why is your shock ability, which lets you shoot out a very quick bolt of electricity? Most important of all though is B, which is your dash. There is a lot of melee in Atomic Heart, and you will need to learn how to effectively dash if you wish to avoid incoming damage. Polymer is the main resource you will need for your personal and glove ability leveling trees, and the double dash is one of the first you should go for. As far as the various glove abilities are concerned, my favorite was Mass Telekinesis. By the end of my playthrough, I was picking up every enemy around me in a 50-foot radius and slamming them to the ground for most, if not all, of their health. There are multiple glove abilities ranging from freezing sprays to polymer shields and the incredibly useful polymer spray. The spray coats enemies and the environment in a polymer liquid that adds extra damage and effects to your elemental attacks. There's a lot to this combat system, from how it works to the depth of its upgrades. One issue I had on multiple occasions though was that difficulty balance. There are a few bosses and multiple rooms where the game would just send 10 to 20 combatants at me, which felt far more difficult than the rest of the time. This is Munfish's first game, and it shows through on those occasions. The story though is fantastic, and the combat is damn good most of the time, so let's break down the mission setup. Atomic Heart might have the most, "I have reached a door, now I must backtrack or visit side areas to find keys to open it" sections of any game in recent memory. The number of times I thought I was done with an area, only to find that the exit door required me to turn in another direction, go fight and solve puzzles for 30 to 60 minutes, and then head back, was extremely high. Narratively, the game does a great job of explaining why this happens, and most of the times you are visiting new areas as you do it. Still, I found myself exasperated occasionally when "go to door A" invariably meant that I was going to go there, get told that I needed to find key items, and then turn around and look for new paths to tread before finally coming back to that same door much later. The opening section of the game is an on-rails type of affair for a while, where you get a lot of story and world building as you meander around a parade and head to a laboratory. After a few hours of pretty linear progression, you'll finally emerge into the open world, at which point a small slice of the map is available. Atomic Heart feels like a less restrictive Metro Exodus, because the entire map is still never fully available at one time, and you can't normally backtrack to an area once you've left it. And that goes for the post-game as well. I found multiple endings, and neither of them allowed me to go back into the game once I was completed with it. I found the bosses to be mostly fantastic, with the dizzying animations and pretty easy to read attack patterns. The first was a massive difficulty spike that forced me to learn the upgrade system, but none took me more than 3 or 4 tries on normal. Outside of combat, there are a lot of puzzles, with the majority of them being a few very fun door lock puzzles and an extremely basic laser grid one. The door lock puzzles consist of dot matching, finger snapping, and Skyrim-style lock picking, and they were just tricky enough to be satisfying but never annoying. There are multiple other puzzle types available throughout the main campaign, and they get reused in the challenge dungeon polygon areas. In those, the difficulty is ramped up for puzzle and combat alike, and the best I could tell, if you don't do every polygon in an area before moving on, there didn't seem to be a way to go back, so make sure you hit them up when you can, if you want. Atomic Heart does have a lot of dialogue in the game, and you can make multiple choices in most conversations, but I don't think they change anything, and the lines could be repeated as often as you wanted with most NPCs. It was another reminder that it's their first game because I had a lot of bugs where dialogue would play on top of itself, repeat unprompted, or subtitle boxes would linger until I had done a full game quit and reopen. I ran into a lot of bugs and performance issues, including a few that almost sunk my entire playthrough. Graphically though, Atomic Heart looks great on the Series X. I did start my playthrough on PC, and my AMD rig with its 5800X and RX 6700 XT ran the game at ultra settings in 1440p while averaging around 80 to 100 FPS. The Series X aims for a dynamic 4K 60, and it seemed to hold it almost consistently in gameplay. But the biggest hit graphically that I noticed were the shadows, which were clearly defined on PC, but the console versions were obviously a low setting, and cutscenes were a mixed bag on console, with an aim for 60 FPS that was very rarely hit. Some of them even dropped into what felt like the teens occasionally. There was a clear shift in the quality setting as well when the game attempted to shift from a cutscene directly back into gameplay. The frame rate would jump back up to 60, and then the detail on textures and shadows would nosedive. There are also some dreamlike sequences where the world shifts around you as well, and when that happened, the texture pop-in and stutter hit hard for a split second every time. I don't believe the game is using most of the new Unreal Engine 5 features. Still, it looks fantastic, and the art style of this alternate USSR can be downright stunning. The scale outdoors is immense, with zero loading screens outside of starting up the game fresh or coming back from a death. The title is coming to previous generation of consoles as well, but I don't have any of those laying around. I can't imagine it'll run particularly well on any of them in the outdoor sections. Indoor may work well though, and the game does have a lot of it that takes place inside. Also, there is a surprising amount of gore, in hilariously terrible ways. You'll come across hundreds of corpses, and more often than not, you can chop them into a pile of disparate arms, legs, upper torso, lower torso, and head. And the detail on the gore is pretty darn high for the human models. You can even cut up the robot enemies as well in a similar fashion, and I kinda loved it. But the biggest issues I had were those numerous graphical and gameplay bugs that I ran into. Sometimes enemies would spawn into walls or ceilings and their AI would break as they couldn't figure out how to get to me. That was normally a plus, as I could just smack them in the back for a bit until they died. The problem was that twice though it happened with a mini boss that I had to kill before I could proceed. He was stuck up in the ceiling and immune to damage. So that meant closing the game, opening it back up, and hoping that they spawned in correctly this time. The worst though was a room in one of the mid-game missions which refused to spawn its floors and wall textures. This meant every time I walked into that, I fell forever. I even let it go for 20 minutes at one point, just to see if it would ever end, and it didn't. After 3 full system restarts failed to load the room properly, I ended up uninstalling the game and re-downloading all 77 gigabytes of it. And thankfully that worked, but it is not ideal. Atomic Heart defaults to English, but you should not use that if you can use subtitles properly. The English VO was like a bad 90s Z movie. It just wasn't very good, but thankfully there are 8 other voiceovers available. I used the original Russian audio track with English subtitles, and it was fantastic. Occasionally, well, often, my character would talk during combat and no subtitles showed up though. And some of the in-game computer text that gave backstory and lore ended up being in Russian only as well, but that only happened to me twice near the very end. Other than those issues, the Russian VO and the written English translation were superb. Atomic Heart is really smart, and impressively, it's funny as hell. Few video games are ever genuinely funny, and even fewer never delve into cringe. Atomic Heart never once missed on a joke or plot point for me. your character isn't an idiot to advance things, and no character really is. There are a ton of secrets and varied motivations, and it always felt earned when I found out why something had been keeping something from someone else. The characters have depth, and none fit an easy-to-define mold. From the crazy granny with her flying house to even the main protagonist, they all end up being pretty realistic with their motivations, abilities, and faults. Another major highlight is the soundtrack. All those great songs from the trailers over the years are here, and there's even a reason why current pop music makes sense in the radio of the future. It's a plot device that uses quantum computing and polymer to guess what music up to 80 years in the future will sound like. There's a lot of licensed Russian pop and rap and rock music that ends up fitting the tone of the game and its absurdist takes well. I also grew to love the little piano ditty that plays while you're in the upgrade screen. Wrapping things up, Atomic Heart is an excellent game, and it is an incredible debut title from Munfish. Clever storytelling, massive set pieces, fun combat, and more make this one very easy to recommend. I mean, hell, it's on Game Pass day one, so go pre-install it and get ready to enjoy one ridiculous ride.